honestly, that's massive. Twitter, Instagram, stuff like that. Social media wise, just like volume and people sharing, people talking about specific stuff about the show. Like, I like it when people make up their own hashtags and then suddenly that hashtag is a thing. Like, you came up with a really dirty one yesterday. I can't remember what it is.
No, I totally, well, it's burned in my mind.
But that's really impactful. Just, and then you get a sense of like rhythm, like you see like multiple people from all over kind of responding to the show and tweeting about the same moments and the same things and things they like. Like, it doesn't happen in a vacuum. So I think Twitter is still massive. Like, I don't know if I'm dating myself, make myself so old, but that's a big one. And I know other people in positions of power really follow Twitter. So I think that's really important. But all kind of social medias, like people just writing articles and podcasts are really big. There's such an influx now too. I really noticed this during my night at Urbis. Like, there's a lot of LGBT reporters and people who are kind of finding their own niche and reporting about shows they think, or any media or books or what have you, that kind of cater to a specific audience. So people are paying attention to that stuff, and we certainly are. So, and one sort of begets another, and you kind of follow it.
All of you are like so well versed in this and so smart. I want to open this up to, like, if there's anything you want to bring up before we open this to fan question, to audience questions. Like, are there any burning thoughts, questions, or things you want to bring up?
Yeah, I would just like to
Picklestein.
#Picklestein. No, I would just like to bring up, you know, the importance of your viewership and the importance of your dollars. Money talks, you know, subscribe to channels like Tello Films. It's the price of a cup of coffee a month, and you get tons of original queer content. Stuff like that is so important, and like, if you want some more queer characters, watch those shows. Like, we just had, you know, Laverne Cox's show on CBS, Doubt. You know, it was a legal procedural, and it was the first, you know, transgender main character of a series, and there was so much fanfare about it. It aired 2 episodes and it tanked because no one watched it. So it's like really important, even if you're not home, leave the TV on that channel. That's probably terrible for like the environment. Maybe don't do that. But really, like, seek out queer material, seek out queer characters, queer creators, queer friendly creators, and really show them some love, show them some bucks, because like, that's how we get the content that we want to see.
And also just keep creating your own stuff too.
Yes.
I mean, these fandoms, everyone is so creative in these fandoms, it's insane. I think when we start to see this generation of budding fanfic turn like writers, that's going to be the future of our content. So keep going.
You should all, I'm sorry, I'm going to jump in just real quick before you, Bridget. Like, you should all be taking like pictures of your shirts and your art and your stuff, and you need to be sending that to Sci-Fi. To
send it to Sci-Fi.
Yes, send it to Sci-Fi.
And they asked, I got a text this morning from my executive who's like, hey, can you show me pictures of all the Nicole Hawk cosplayers and all that stuff? And I'm like, yes.
Well, Emily told us like straight up, this shit matters. So, yeah. Okay, sorry.
No, I was just going to build on the power of positivity, like, to keep talking about the things that you love, and like, just to echo the sentiments. Like, it's important to call out the stuff that's wrong, it's important to say this is bad, but it's so much more powerful to say, you guys are doing it right, like, more of this, please. Because, like, who doesn't want to be told that, oh, Emily, you're so smart, like, she acts like she's, no, but, like, they, like, yeah, if you're like making something and you're getting positive feedback on it, you're just gonna want to do it more. So like, just keep being positive, I think, about it.
All right, so I'd love it if some of you would ask some questions of this wonderful panel. I'm going to hand over one of these mics. We're gonna have to share a little bit more, because if you don't mind, can we just hand off one of these? Thank you. San Junipero. Okay, so yeah, just walk on up.
I know.
Go ahead.
And we have just been talking about like not watching what was it called again, the 100. For the reason, I mean, I know everybody unfollowed Jason Rothenberg and everything, but the 100, even though it killed Lexa, still is the only show with bisexual. Well, actually, it's the second show was How to Get Away with Murder. Was a bisexual lead character, like with a teenage bisexual lead character. get exposition as a bisexual character. So I wanted to be like, should we give the show a chance to support it, or is it like oh no, you have burned us?
I think that's a personal decision for sure. If you want to support that show because you feel like that is representing you, absolutely. I think that it's doing so many other things wrong that that's where it sort of hits that bar for me. It wasn't just killing Lexa, it was killing Lincoln. It was treating quite a few other characters quite poorly, disabled characters. The list is like never ending. I mean, we've all seen it on Twitter. But you should always support something that you love, and if you feel like that is good for you and positive for you,
okay. Well, I'm gay, but bisexuals have like such a representation and such a diverse and positive representation that, and it's like such a vulnerable community that I feel that I need to support them in any way I can, and that's why it's like such a tricky subject, because a lot of shows don't do everything right, and I, as much as I love Lost Girl, it also did have its missteps, and maybe what my plea would be for the, social media, the queer social media, is that it's not just like, you're doing this wrong, we hate you so much, because a lot of the queer social media backlash can be like super negative, like super derogative, and to be like more productive, basically.
I mean, you're making excellent points. That's nothing that you said is not true.
However,
there isn't a however. I mean, that's just simply true, and it's hard. I mean, I'm a person that writes about TV, and people get pissed at me sometimes. You know, like it happens. And the thing is, I think a lot of 100 fans are really torn about this. I mean, raise your hand if you were super torn because you love Clark. I mean, I freaking love Clark. But what happened and what that show did to this community, as somebody who is able to have a voice for this community, I can't. I personally can't. But I totally get what you're saying.
I also really don't like the idea of, like, being thrown a bone, you know, and not a very good bone. The way so much, like... Every single person that Clark has slept with on that show or been with on that show is either dead or, you know, beat up. I don't, if it's not positive representation, I personally cannot support it whatsoever. I want good bisexual characters.
I agree, and it sucks when the shows that we love fuck up. It does. I mean, I love Orange is the New Black, but when they killed off Poussey, I was furious. You know, I was sorry. Guys, it was on last year. Watch it already.
Did we seriously just have a spoiler thing? Spoiler.
I got bad.
Oh no, she was like, she was just upset about Poussey. She had. We're all totally understandable.
So it's it's a tough position, and it is a personal choice. You know, it's if you want to watch something, watch it. If you don't. Don't, but it's tough. Like, shows fuck up, writers fuck up, recappers fuck up. You know, that's just, we're all human and we're all people.
Were you the only question?
Oh, no, hey.
Oh, I love the guys.
They're just sitting down, Saturday
afternoon. Are you guys kneeling in fealty? What's going on over there?
It finally happened!
Multiple questions, but I'm only going to ask one.
Go ahead, ask a couple.
Oh, really? Okay, great. Okay. First, okay, so we've mentioned Sam Mers a lot so far this weekend, and I'm sure I'm not the only one in the room who is very frustrated right now with how that show is treating that couple.
I want to hear you tell me
why I'm frustrated.
Yeah, 30 seconds as a writer. Like, honestly, tell me exactly what is frustrating. I realize you don't speak for everyone, but
now you do. No pressure.
No, I'm so serious. I want you to say exactly out loud, as someone who's only on season one,
what
is frustrating you.
Right, so speaking specifically about Sanders, because there's a whole other issue with Kara, which we could talk about. And feminism on television and how they've destroyed her character and her relationship with her sister, but again, another panel. So Sam specifically, when we keep bringing up the most recent, the Valentine's Day episode, where it felt very reminiscent of how we all were treated with Clexa, where there was a lot of baiting going on in the weeks leading up to that, because first they said it was going to be on the 13th, and said, oh, it's a Valentine's Day episode, it's all about Sam versus this couple, and we all got really excited, and then they bumped it to the next week, but they still were billing it as a Sandra-centric episode. And I think they got maybe 2.5 minutes of screen time in a 40-minute TV show. And on top of that, the thing that they are focusing on is a white, cis, heterosexual couple where the man is very problematic. They normally are, but I mean, this one specifically is really bad. And so, to Tara's point earlier, you know, she said, if it's not going well, turn it off. But as someone who tries to see the perspective of everyone, I mean, the writers have written things in a vacuum a lot of times, right? And they need a little bit of lead time to hear what we're saying to realize, oh shit, we fucked up. Let's fix it.
Not making excuses. Sometimes too, they've also like written the whole season,
right? Okay,
and so like then you see the response, and you're like, oh god.
So this is exactly.
I'm not making excuses at all, but like you do very much right now.
Yeah, this is exactly my question. At what point do you check out? Because like I had a moment on Monday night where I was like, okay, I'm done. And 2 weeks ago, 2 months ago, a year ago, I would have died for that show. I would have told everyone to watch that show.
Every relationship you check out when it doesn't make you feel good anymore. Like, that's when you check out, right? Like, when you break up, when it doesn't make you feel happy. Especially, I think, with your entertainment, to be honest. Like, if you, especially something like Supergirl, which is, like, so joyous and about, you know, whatever it is. It's supposed to be joyous. No, I mean, like, seriously, staying neutral. It's supposed to be about a girl who's super. If it doesn't make you feel super, I would say...
There's 500 and
there's
so
like
many
5,000
other
shows.
Yeah.
Shows, and, like, you can have hope. Like, I think that's okay too, right? Like, I think part of the pain of Clexa as well, which we see, is like, there were moments of grace and beauty with that relationship, right? If we're being totally honest, the reason there's so much devastation is because there was something really unique and the chemistry was incredible, and for a moment that was really wonderful, right? That's fair to say. We wouldn't care, it wouldn't have broken out.
Exactly.
I was like, at like 7 seconds. But I just mean like, that's what's so heartbreaking about that. It's like any breakup, right? When do you know it's over? And so often with my breakups, I've known it's over before I actually said it was over.
Right.
But,
yeah. Okay. So the second question really quickly. So as someone who was very much involved in the soap universe back in the day, Team Italia forever. Next year, guys, right? The way that we got things done in that fandom was being really positive and writing letters and doing postcards and going on fan forums and saying the things that we loved about the relationship. So that was the, I think that's why I took to Winona Earp so quickly, is because it was the same feeling, right? But the other side of that is what happened with Clexa. It was very much, how dare you, and there was a lot of negativity. I'm not saying in a bad way, right? Because we were all hurt and like it was real people that were affected. And I'm just curious, to writers as well as creators, which do you think gets to the people who are making decisions better? Being positive about something and pointing, I know what Bridget's gonna say, because she's already said it, positivity is the way to go, but what is more successful, positivity or pointing out things that you are, because I'd really love to point out the shit that's making me angry about Sandbers, but I keep trying to find the things that are good, because that's the only thing that ever gets retweeted. When I live tweet that show, if I say bad stuff, it never gets retweeted, but the minute I say something like nice, the director of the episode will retweet it, or the writer will retweet it or something, and so I don't know what's better.
Well, nobody likes, Amy, listen, you have every right to be angry, you have every right to be pissed, it's your right to say what you need to say. Nobody likes to be told that they should, like, die in a house fire, like, you know, I mean, I've had people tell me that, and it's not fun, and I'm not gonna retweet that. Also, someone called Dana a Sith Lord on Twitter. Dare you? And I got a text from Dana that was like, someone called me a Sith Lord. And I was like, you are not a Sith Lord, you're a Jedi. But I mean, I think it's important to be open to negative criticism. There's a fine line between being abusive and just like saying like, you've really upset me and I don't like this and this needs to change. And I think that it's easy for people to focus on the stuff like, you're dying in a house fire, than to say like, I'm a queer person and this is really devastating to me. It, you know, that is not as easy to focus on as the like hardcore negative. And it's easy to lump all that together and be like, oh, they're just so angry, right? Bunch of angry lesbians.
Oh, I was just gonna say, That's the thing, I don't think it has to be negative. I think it's about educating people on it, and it's about raising awareness. Like, a lot of the trends we did, LGBT fans deserve better wasn't a negative trend. It was just to get that voice out there. Tell your story, but you don't have to tear apart the show while you're doing it. Tell them what they did wrong, how they can do better, but also, you know, be positive when it is positive. I think you just have to have a balance of both. Maybe don't tell anyone to kill themselves.
This question is for Emily. Emily, we're just wondering, you know, you guys are great for like fan interaction on Twitter. Thank you. The wife and I are West Coast, so we always have that battle of like, do we wait to watch it, or do we kind of like get on Twitter?
Like mute us.
Exactly. So we were wondering if Sci-Fi was going to maybe push it back on the West Coast, or maybe try to make it a little bit more.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, and I think there were a couple episodes where I did stay on the West Coast, but then it's like 5 a.m. and I'm like, hurrah. yeah, I think that's not a terrible idea. IDW is certainly looking at that, because it is, it sucks to miss out, right? And we really, like, so much of our success was creating this kind of party, like, everyone's invited to the party, you can say all sorts of stuff, and the cast is going to say kooky stuff, so we definitely want to keep that atmosphere, so we'll see. Yeah, you're welcome. Thanks for watching anyway. You can mute me. I won't know.
Hi, everyone. There's been a lot of talk this weekend about gaining the representation you want to see by giving money to the people who are making those things, right, and getting involved that way. For those of us who only have so much money to go around, I'm wondering where the intersection is between using social media to gain the representation that you want to see and... So what do you feel are the most impactful ways that we can use social media for that? And as a bi trans person, I don't see myself on TV. I'm wondering how can I help get that message out?
Well, number one, I want someone to make a web series about bi trans guys and
I would love to.
Well, no, I'm serious. Like, it breaks my heart that you don't see yourself. I know what it's like to not see yourself. I'm a little bit older than some of you. And I remember what that was like. And so, listen to your community, right? He's saying, I don't feel represented. And we can make that happen in a lot of ways. We can tell the people that have the power, maybe the money, we want this to happen. So it's about coming together. It's about talking to people like myself and Chelsea, like people who are writers and can, you know, I mean, I'm not gonna say like I'm tapped into Emily, but like I'm gonna tell her what you guys tell me because it's important.
I wanna say like when we say money, I also mean like literally you watching the show is ratings, which translates into advertising dollars. Like, you know, you gotta give me your paycheck, although I will accept it. But like, seriously, that's what I kind of mean by money. Like, that's the way networks think, right? Is, oh my God, 5 million people are watching it. That means I can sell more soap, right? To soap companies. So like, honestly, you really do see social media movements on Twitter, like, all the time. I think just supporting those hashtags, getting involved with the fandom, finding your people and then kind of grouping and making plans and making like timed hashtags and stuff like that is really effective, like having a day. But I do hope you see yourself on television sometime.
And
I'll try. I'll keep trying. You give me some Game of Thrones money. I'll show up you guys as I'm around.
Also,
riding a dragon.
If you don't want. If you don't have the money, share your talents, you know?
And your time.
Share your talents and your time. Like, if you're an artist, like, make some awesome art and post it all over the damn place. Like, that stuff matters. It all adds up. Go ahead.
Hello.
Hi.
Terry, you don't have to answer this question because you've probably heard me ask it like a million times. But, I do academic stuff. I write about representation of LGBTQ people and women on television. And we're kind of like out here in our ivory tower, not connecting with any other industry or anything else.
So what can we as academics do to kind of connect with like the entertainment side or just to kind of make awareness happen?
I'll answer it again if you want. and this is, I think I've said the same thing to you like three times, but you can all hear the rant.
I didn't hear it.
Thank you. I'll speak directly to you.
I feel bad that I'm like asking this question.
That's okay. What we're doing at LGBT Fans is we're trying to bridge the gap. We're trying to take the people who have the time and the skills to research and look into these shows, and then we can report it in a way that hopefully will eventually get to the writers. No, so far we've done all right, but you know, I'll get to the media. Anyone that will listen, and we're totally willing to give a platform to the people who are willing to do it. And we do take volunteers. Please come and see us at our booth.
And I do think just, you know, again, this is why social media is so great, she said as she spilled her beer. Get that drunk off the stage. No. But really, what's so cool about Twitter and social media is you can send a message to Emily Andras and she will read it, probably. Like, you can talk to all of these writers and creators. The boundaries that were there before don't exist anymore. So reach out to the actors, the writers, the creators, the other academics. You know, like that to me is like by far the best avenue to kind of get into contact, start a relationship, start talking.
I've found that people really like pretty, pretty pictures. And so like, if you're in the academics, if like you can translate what's going on with all the numbers into like graphs seem to have, like Mo Ryan has had. Yeah. Or like when Auto Straddle had the graphs about the barrier gay stuff. Like I feel like academics, obviously, you're probably buried in numbers. Like if you can like translate that to the common folk, yeah, like translate it for the common folk, like make us understand it. Like yeah,
send it to us and we'll do it.
Oh,
thank you. Okay, sorry, I'm super nervous.